really delighted to welcome Theresa Sotto from the Hammer Museum in LA to the Best of Heritage 2020. Welcome, Theresa. I would like to ask you a few questions about the project that you won. First of all, though, could you describe your institution for us?
Sure, Viv. Thanks so much to you and to the Best in Heritage organizers for inviting me today. The Hammer Museum at UCLA offers exhibitions and collections that span classic to contemporary art. We have more than 50,000 works in our collection, with an incredible collection of works on paper in particular. And our exhibitions often emphasize contemporary artists from the 1960s and beyond, and especially the work of Los Angeles artists and emerging or under-recognized artists. We also present hundreds of programs annually, and all of our programs and exhibitions, I'm so proud to say, are all free to the public. Our programs for K-12 students and teachers, families, and university audiences emphasize critical thinking, creativity, and social awareness through art. The Hammer's mission is that we believe in the promise of art and ideas to illuminate our lives and build a more just world. And that mission is so near and dear to my heart. The social justice aspect of our mission is a key motivator for me and the educational initiatives that I oversee. My team and I develop educational programs that are designed with and for diverse communities and are implemented with a commitment to equity and inclusion.
It sounds totally wonderful, Theresa. Congratulations on winning this project. Could you now tell us something about the awarded project, the rationales and the history of that?
Absolutely. Classroom in Residence at the Hammer is a really unique program that is designed to strengthen student and teacher learning about art. We specifically work with two classes of fourth, fifth, and sixth grade students who learn at the Hammer as if it was their school for 5 consecutive days. In preparation for this arts-rich experience, the teachers participate in 8 months of professional development, guided by both the museum staff as well as our partners in the School of the Arts and Architecture at UCLA, and in particular, a program called, that we like to call VAPA, short for the Visual and Performing Arts Education Program. And we all work directly with the teachers to ensure that the students have the most beneficial arts-rich experience that is informed by the expertise of both museum and university staff. The program began in 2012 with an emphasis on student learning during the 5-day residency, and since then it has expanded to have a rigorous teacher training component. And this is so that we ensure that teachers not only are able to prepare for the residency at the museum, but are able to integrate the arts into their curricula long after the residency is over, so that the students in the next year and the next year also get an incredible arts-rich experience. We have 3 main goals for students. We want them to connect to works of art personally, contextually, and cross-curricularly. We want them to feel like the museum is a place of enjoyment and employment. And we want them to be able to tap into their creativity and see art as an ability to engage both in self-expression and also social awareness. For teachers, we want them to be able to incorporate the strategies that they learn through the program, not just in the residency, as I mentioned, but so that for years on, they're very comfortable giving arts instruction to their students, which is so key. The arts are drastically underfunded in Los Angeles, and we need all the help we can get from generalist teachers who may not have been able to integrate the arts or teach arts at all prior to this program. I believe that the immersive and transformative learning that takes place at the Hammer Museum through this program is one of the main reasons why it received the prestigious award given to it by the American Alliance of Museums, specifically the 2019 EdCom Award for Excellence in Programming.
Yes, you did brilliantly well to get that award, so congratulations on that. Could you tell us what particular qualities or innovations you think really impressed the judges of that award?
Sure. Well, most people go to a museum on a field trip, most students do, take about an hour to 2 hours, maybe breeze through the galleries, see the highlights of a museum. And in Los Angeles, the bus ride alone may be about an hour to get to the museum. So Classroom in Residence offers an alternative. It offers something different. It gives students the ability to slow down, to look at a work of art for 30 minutes or more, and to really engage deeply with what the work is asking of us, so that they're not just running in, seeing a work, going to the next one, taking a selfie. It really is about making the museum their home and making the museum their school sort of simultaneously. We've seen some really disengaged students come alive in this program, and I often think of a fifth grade student named Brody, who had started the beginning of the residency very disengaged, didn't want to participate in any of the large school, the large group activities, and was very shy and quiet and didn't want to share out in the discussions. By the fifth day of the residency, though, he really opened up and he shared with one of the teaching artists that his brother had passed away. And the teaching artist suggested that he channel his grief into his art project. The art project at the time was inspired by a work of conceptual art called Al's Cafe by an artist named Alan Rupersberg. And that project involved essentially plates, meals that were conceptual in nature. And the challenge to the students was to create a plate or a meal that is inspired by their lives. And most of the meals that the students created, most of these plates that they designed, were colorful, vibrant, images of family and sports, video games, hobbies. And Brody's plate, I remember so clearly that he created a very dark plate representing his loss with an angel represented and God depicted on the plate. So I do feel like this program is able to impact students in a way that transforms their ability to use art as a way to capture their experiences. And also the teachers are transformed as well. We've had teachers that say, I never used to integrate art into my classroom, and now I do it almost every day.
Wow, that's really inspiring. Thank you. What a moving story, gosh.
Yeah.
Oh wow. Well, I'm sure it wasn't all plain sailing, although you've had a long history of this project. What particular difficulties did you experience along the way? And maybe a positive experience too you could share with us.
Yeah, well, one of the great strengths of this program is perhaps one of the most challenging aspects of the program, and that's the collaborative nature of it. As I mentioned, we work really closely with our partners in the VAPA program, and that program at UCLA, there's a lot of shared goals around arts education, but when you're thinking about the specific desires within museum education to be grounded in works of art, and UCLA professors that are all about creative expression, creative process, we definitely have to find a middle ground so that all of our shared goals can connect. And then you bring in the classroom teacher who has so many other goals as well, that are so much about classroom culture as much as it is about curricular standards. And so the challenge of this program is, how can we all meet together? What shared goals do we have in common, and how do we arrive at those goals? I will say that that process takes a lot of time. We have endless meetings. We look at lesson plans together over and over. And we are able to, as a result, create something after all of that work that is a completely beautiful collaboration that brings in expertise from the teacher who knows the students best, university expertise grounded in research, museum expertise grounded in professional practice, and no lesson on in and of itself would be as powerful without all of those voices, but it does take a lot of time.
Yes, and many years of practice to get it perfect. Yes, yeah.
Certainly.
Yeah, your collaborative practice, I'm hugely impressed with that because it's really intense, and I'm sure that's a great strength of your program. Would you tell us a little bit more about the pre-residency and the pre-residency lessons that were taught by the students?
Sure. The UCLA VAPA teaching artists that I mentioned are students at UCLA or recently graduating from UCLA, and they have participated in a really rigorous program with a lot of coursework that gives them the foundation to teach arts education in classroom settings. When they come into this program, they have that foundation already, and they've already started teaching a little bit in the classroom. But this program gives them the opportunity to have even more experience working in the classroom, and also the experience of working in a team and being able to enter into a room where maybe a professor is there, a classroom teacher who's been in the classroom for 15 years, museum professionals, and to share that space with their own knowledge and their own expertise and their own creative thinking, and to be able to offer up a lesson plan that both meets the goals of the program but also brings in their own special creative pursuits or mark making into the mix. So they go into the classroom before the residency to start some foundational conversations about art instruction, to build some art vocabulary and skills so that the students are best prepared for the residency when they arrive. During the residency, they engage with works of art and lead conversations about the works, followed by art making activity that the teaching artist can implement and show them how to take what they're learning in the galleries and applying it to their own creative works. After the residency, the teaching artists go back into the classroom to extend learning so that the students are able to make connections further into their curricula and into their personal lives so that there's a really nice and very long thread of connection that happens with both the UCLA students and the students in the classroom.
It's a lovely element because they're closer to the student's age in a way, aren't they? So it's like a step on the way to working in the museum or becoming a teacher themselves, I guess. I thought that was a really lovely thing that you did. You were talking a little bit about the your process of close looking and engaging students in dialogue so that they improve their critical thinking skills. I didn't know if you would have an example that you could share with us of maybe a string of questions that would relate to perhaps social justice issues, or is that too difficult a question?
Not at all. The Hammer has a range of exhibitions that are engaging with social topics that are really pressing and important for our time. And in that way, it's unavoidable to talk about social justice when you have a program at the Hammer Museum. So we always rely first on the works of art that we're engaging with and let a lot of the topics related to societal inequities, to race, to class, it comes from the artists and the artwork that we're seeing. And then we apply a series of different kinds of strategies and tools so that students are unpacking the artwork in the way that they see it. One framework that I think is an easy and concise framework that I can share in this format is called OASIS. And that's an acronym that stands for Observe, Ask, Select, Infer, and Support. And this model is helpful for students to first begin with observation. What is it that they see in the artwork? What is the artwork telling us? Then we ask students to ask questions. So we ask them to pose a list of several questions without answering them. And then the onus is on them to select the question that is most pressing for them, either individually or in groups. And then they have to answer their own question with inference and support from the works of art. And so in this way, the experience of looking at art is guided by the students' own interests, their own questions. And the social justice aspect of this framework is reliant on the works of art themselves. So we really spend a lot of time thinking about which works of art to choose, which will resonate with students in our communities. And because of our own interests as an institution, to further social justice, we make it a point to include artworks that are tackling some challenging subjects.
Wow. I know that your communities are really very largely economically disadvantaged, aren't they? So I'm sure that there are some questions that you want to ask me now, some things that you'd like to highlight related to what's going on today. So,
educators at the Hammer, overall, we practice a conversational style of teaching, and I see it as a political act. It's not a way of teaching, a pedagogy that is reliant on a singular perspective. It's not reliant on lecture and knowledge from one individual that's sort of sharing it out for other people to absorb. Instead, our style of teaching is about encouraging other people to share their perspectives, giving a safe space where other people, no matter where you come from, what your background is, how old you are, whether or not you've ever been to a museum, your response, your idea, your insight matters. And we invite all of those insights, all of those questions into the space of the gallery. So I see that as a very radical way of ensuring that people feel safe and heard in museum spaces. And one thing that weighs heavily on my mind these days is how museums can best respond to the current civil unrest. How can we best support Black Lives Matter? And the Classroom in Residence program does what is at the heart of a lot of racial justice initiatives, which is creating a space for people of color to feel safe, to feel welcome, to feel heard, and to amplify their voices. And if only all museums, all cultural institutions across the world had opportunities for students to feel that way in their space, I think we'd all be doing an incredible service to make this world a better place to combat the racism that is pervasive in our society.
Well, I totally agree with you. I think that the work that you do is hugely important, so much so today and the world over. So thank you very, very much for sharing those important programs with us. And I look forward to seeing you perhaps next year, really, in Dubrovnik. But meanwhile, thank you very much, Teresa.
Thank you so much, Viv.